In our Bibles in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we're going to be reading just one verse tonight. And like I said, it has been a joy to be here tonight. Just felt the Spirit and just glad to see God's people that's willing to do things for Him. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we're going to be taking our text, verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. And here the Bible says, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." I'd like to speak to you just briefly tonight on when the new creature starts feeling kind of old. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for this time to come together in your house. Lord, we just thank you so much for the Spirit we felt. We thank you for each person that's coming to worship. I pray that we've done everything that you want us to do. And Lord, I'm just asking now that you help me be able to bring this word the way you want it brought. Lord, you know that I can't preach without you. I'm just asking for your help. Please just bless this word, bless this service. Open our minds and hearts to receive these things I ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and 17, the Apostle Paul speaking here to the church at Corinth. And, you know, I've heard this thing preached and taught and talked about my entire life, my entire 45 years. Every time you go into a church service, it seems like somebody's talking about this passage of Scripture. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, and I tell you that it's always been a kind of a sticking point for me. It's always been a problem for me when I hear this sometimes preached on, because a lot of times folks want to just take this and pull it right out of the Scripture, out of context, and use it for their own means to kind of beat people up, actually. I've heard people beat up with using this Scripture and saying if a man, you know, has been saved, then he immediately should be changed. Because the Bible says that, you know, once you become in Christ, you become a new creature and old things have passed away and all things become new. And that is true. That is absolutely true. But it seems that some want to act like that's an immediate process of becoming this new creature. Now, while it's true that we do become new, brand new inside, our hearts, our souls, our destiny has been changed. We are brand new. But this renewal process takes time. It's something that we do, and we're going to talk about that in just a little bit. But I don't like to hear folks get beat up with Scripture. Never have. I like to preach it the way the Word says it's to be broad in what it means. So one thing that we want to look at tonight is what this Scripture does not say. Instead of what it does say, we see what it says, but what does it not say? One thing, it doesn't say this is an immediate event, that we become this new creature, the one that Christ expects us to become, this new creature all of a sudden. I'll never make the statement that anything like you better check up on your salvation or something like that. You'll never hear that out of my mouth. I don't like that. I don't like to hear anyone question someone's salvation. The only person that can do that is Jesus Christ. He's the only one that knows our minds, our hearts, our souls, and where our destiny lies. We can't do that. I can't look at you and tell you if you're saved or not. But Jesus can. And I go on what people tell me. If people tell me they're saved, they're saved. I'm saved tonight. I accepted Christ as my Savior 7 years old, and He lives within me. But tonight we're going to look at this, and first of all, I want to tell you where this is coming from. This is in Paul preaching the church of Corinth. And they had a problem at that time. A lot of people were wanting to boast. They wanted to boast of what they had seen, who they had known, who they'd been saved under, and things like that. Some of these folks had known Jesus. They had seen Jesus in the flesh. Paul was not one of those. He did not see Jesus in the flesh before his crucifixion and resurrection. So Paul is bringing this from he's got a better viewpoint on the grace of God than some of those that actually saw Christ in the flesh. Because some of those wanted to boast, well, I knew Jesus. I saw Jesus. I saw these miracles that were performed. And therefore, you know, I can boast and all these things. Well, Paul's trying to tell these folks, look, we're not going to boast in those things of the flesh like that. What we can talk about tonight is how Christ has moved in our heart and we become new creatures in Him. And we can just know that, you know, through Christ that we become spiritual creatures. We're not, it's not based on our flesh. And so let's look at that in verse 12. We're going to back up, just go up to 2 Corinthians 5 and 12. And he says, "For we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that you may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance, and not in heart. For whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God. And whether we be sober, it is for your cause. For the love of Christ constraineth us. Because we thus judge that if one died for all, then were all dead. And that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. So, Paul, as I mentioned, has kind of a better viewpoint of the grace of Christ because he didn't know him personally. He didn't see him here in the flesh until he was met with him on that road to Damascus. And we know that Paul was called up to that third heaven at one time. But he's saying here, you know, it's not the Christ after the flesh. It's the one that we know that abounds in grace, the one that saves us. It's more important that we know him spiritually instead of fleshly. Many of them, like I said, could brag. And we know of one point in the scripture where they were bragging that they were saved under so-and-so. And Paul was saying, you know, we're not going there. You're not putting me up on a pedestal or anything like that. And so this was something that he was trying to teach this church. And, it's boasting is a problem for a lot of people. And a man, there's one thing about men and women, the human flesh, sometimes we'll get in that boastful attitude. And that can be our downfall. The Lord hates a prideful look, a proud look. And sometimes our pride can just blow us up. And I've told you the story before, but about, I guess it's been 17 years now, when I was first preaching, and I was interim pastor at House Mountain. And I had this flock of these women that would come up to me after church and just go on and on about how just wonderful I did and how good I was doing and all that stuff. You know, and I appreciate that now. Folks tell me, you know, if they enjoyed the message. But it would just blow me up. I was just starting out, you know, and my head was just getting bigger and bigger and bigger, and I could barely fit through the front door. And then the Lord brought me down. Boy, he kicked that stool out from under me, and I hit rock bottom. And I learned a terrible, horrible lesson in humility. And I vowed the Lord I would never let that happen to me again. Now, I appreciate when folks come and say they've enjoyed the message or something. But, you know, when I preach, I would rather folks go away from here saying, man, what a Lord that we have. What a God that we serve. Instead of what a way that guy talked. What a good job he did. So anything that we do for the Lord, it's all for his glory and his honor. Nothing that we've done. We don't need to boast in this flesh tonight. But the Apostle Paul is trying to warn these folks. You know, let's not be boasting these fleshly things. Let's dwell on the spiritual and what Christ has done for us. Now, like I was mentioning, this is not an immediate process that we become these new creatures in Christ. There's a thing called, it's a process called sanctification. Now, sanctification is our slow spiritual growth in Christ. That is where that we build and we grow in the love of Christ, and we understand the things that he wants for us. And it is a continuous process. Now, salvation is immediate. When you accept Christ as your Savior, he enters into your heart. You're filled with that Holy Spirit. He lives inside of you. Salvation is immediate right then. Sanctification is an ongoing process. So your walk with the Lord is actually a twofold thing. It's his work within you, but you are doing your part as well. So we don't just sit back and say, okay, Lord, do it for me. I'm saved now. Do it for me. Make me holy. Make me spiritual. Make me this man of God you want me to be. That's not how it works. You see, there's a process to go through. It's called obedience. It's called being faithful to him. It's called dwelling on the things of Christ. And we need to renew these minds that we have. When the Bible talks about us being those old creatures, you know, we still have those old thoughts and things back in there. So when you got saved, all those thoughts didn't immediately just go away. And I've heard it preached that, you know, no more will you think about those old things you used to think about. That's certainly not true. If you got saved and you didn't have a thumb on your hand, and then after you got saved you had one, well, that's ridiculous. We know that's not going to happen. Same way with our thought process and our minds. You know, Christ does. He does help us with those things. But we still got those thoughts in there. We still have that sin nature. Paul himself said he was the chiefest of sinners. And we know that all men are sinners. The Bible says that we are. So those things are still going to be there. And so what bothers me the most is when a young Christian comes to Christ, they get saved, and then someone wants to immediately start tearing them down and saying, well, if you're not living the right way, if you're not going to church every time the door's open, if you're not praying this way or that way, you know, there's something wrong with you. Maybe you need to check up. Maybe you wasn't saved. My goodness, how many people have been hurt by that kind of philosophy? It's so untrue. We accept Christ, our Savior, He moves in our heart, and then it's a sanctification process as we grow in His love and Spirit. When we're young Christians in Christ, we're on that milk. You know, we need that milk. We need to learn. You know, it's not going to just happen overnight. So I've had people come to me and say, you know, I went down and I'm pretty sure I was saved. You know, I knew I was lost, and I accepted Christ and asked Him to come to my heart, and then I went to church, and the preacher made me feel so guilty and like I needed to go back down or something. You know, we'll deal with those kinds of things. We had that happen. I had that happen to me when I was a young child. Like I said, I was saved at 7. And then around, I don't know, 11 years old, some preacher stood up and said, you know, if you're not feeling what everybody else is feeling in this church, there must be something wrong with you. Maybe you're not saved. And it just tore me all to pieces. Because I was like, I know I was saved. God, what's happened? Why am I not shouting like that woman over there? Why not raise my hand like that man over there? And so I was felt guilty. Because I wasn't doing these things. It's not in these things. You know, as we grow in Christ and we get closer to Him and we become more spiritual creatures in Him, we will do outward things. You will see some people, you know, raise their hand, you know, praise God. Now, I've never been a one that does that a lot. I like to say amen, you know, but I'm not real loud about it. You know, most of my thoughts for the Lord and all my convictions and everything come through my tears. If you look back at me when you're singing or something and my eyes are closed, I'm trying to keep the tears from just streaming down my face. And I'm holding them back. But, you know, all mine comes through my tears. So I'm not going to judge anybody for their outward expression. You know, that's not how we do it. It's not this fleshly expression, but it's what's within our heart. Now, Paul has been talking about this to this church. You know, one way that we mess up in our thinking in this process of becoming a Christian and a new creature in Christ is we think we have to modify our behavior, which we should. If you're doing, you know, evil things and sinful things, you should modify that. You should not do that. But it's not the modification of the things we do so much. It's the modification of the way we think, the way we use our mind. What goes in the ears and the eyes. You heard that ear gate and eye gate. I always heard that. You know, don't let anything go in your ear gate or your eye gate. You know, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. The Father up above is looking down in love. Be careful, little ears, what you hear. We need to sing that almost every day. Because we're bombarded daily by the things of the world trying to get into our eye gate, our mind gate, our ear gate. And it wants to get in there. You know, Satan has a large part in that. But the world that we live in will attack us. You know, we have to walk through this world. We can't isolate ourselves. We are to separate ourselves from this sinful way of living. You know, we can't mix and mingle with those that are outwardly, you know, defying Christ. But we still have to live here in this world. We can't go and start our own commune in Texas like some of those folks and, you know, isolate ourselves. But we can be separate, a separate people. But the outward expression is not nearly as important as this inward thing that's going on in our minds, our hearts. Romans 12 and 1 says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And verse 2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So it's the renewing of our mind that we need to be concerned about. You know, we're going to still have those thoughts. You know, some people have told me, said, Brother Byron, you know, I thought when I got saved that, you know, Jesus would come and live in me and I wouldn't have those thoughts anymore. You know, those thoughts didn't immediately get erased. What you have to do in cases like that is dwell on the things of the Lord. Renew that mind. It's a spiritual thing, a renewing of. Think on the things of God. Think on things. If you've got something going on in your life, if you're If you're listening to a certain type of music, you're reading a certain type of book, allowing things into your life that you know destroys you, that you know bothers you, stop those things. Because when those things get into your mind and start clouding your judgment, clouding your mind, and that's not a renewal. That's a keep on doing the same thing you've always been doing. So, you know, don't expect to get saved and all of a sudden you're this superhuman Christian. It doesn't work that way. It's a process. It's sanctification. But getting back to that renewing of our mind, and it says that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, perfect will of God. You know, you can see folks. I love to see folks mature in Christ. Watch them from the time they get saved, and then watch their growing process. You see how some folks step up. You see them start working for the Lord, talking about spiritual things in church, where as they used to talk about, ungodly things and things of the world. And I love to see that process as it goes through young minds. That's one thing I've always loved about being a Sunday school teacher is seeing people grow in Christ. It's just a wonderful process that the Lord does for us. But in James chapter 1, verse 8, the Bible says that a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. Let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted, but the rich in that he is made low. Because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away. But the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it wherewith the grass, it withereth the grass, and the flower thereof fall, and the grace of the fashion of it perisheth. So also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. Now, this is the verse I was going to get to. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised for them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then, when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. So we can see James warning us. A lot of the things that happen to us, a lot of problems that we go through, is because of our own sinful lust. Because that we're not doing the things of Christ. We're not dwelling on what He wants us to do. And so we've got to be very careful. But He says, if you are drawn away, if you do this, we do have an advocate, the Father. We need to turn to Him. We need to turn to Him. That's in 1 John. We have an advocate. We need to be very careful in this walk of life, what we listen to, what we watch. I'm not one that censors. I'm not saying I'm going to censor everything. I can't stand that. I think that you should have that censor in here. When Christ is living within you, when you're dwelling on the spiritual things of God, that thing should be telling you, don't watch that. Don't listen to that. Don't say things like that. So, be very careful. Now, some people want to say, well, Brother Byron, it sounds all good and all. But how do we go about this kind of thing? What steps do we take to keep ourselves from falling into that trap, getting back like that old man? Because I'm feeling like that old man again. I'm thinking those old thoughts again. I want to do some of those old things I used to do. So what do we do? What's the Bible say we do? Ephesians 6:10. This is the whole armor of God. It says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand an evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore having your loins girt about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. I always liked to have, or I used to have, some of those signs that had the soldier on, that had on all the armor. It would tell you, each one of the breastplate of righteousness, shot with the preparation of the gospel, all those things. That'd be a wonderful thing, especially for a young Christian, to print out one of those and hang it up, look at it every day. Say, Lord, help me right here. Help me do this. Help me keep that. Help me keep that helmet on so I don't let those things enter in. Keep that breastplate of righteousness. One thing I would like to say tonight, I'm not going to be much longer, I'm about to, is that we need, if you are particularly a young Christian, young folks, those that are young Christians, stop beating yourself up. Stop beating yourself up for every time you fail. And we are going to fail. It's just plain and simple. We're men and women, flesh. We've not reached the level of Christ. We won't do that until we're with Him in heaven. But stop beating yourself up. You're not going to suddenly turn into Mother Teresa or Billy Graham overnight. You know, it doesn't work that way. I just pulled those two. A lot of people know them. But, it's just something that doesn't just happen overnight. There's no magic formula, no pill to take. We just discussed it right here out of the Bible. The Scripture itself tells us how to live. If we read our Scripture daily, we look in there and find what God has for us. Our entire roadmap of life is in this book. We will read this and follow it. How much better we be. So, anything worth doing, my dad always said, anything worth doing is worth doing right. And it is. So, if we're wanting to achieve that creature that Christ wants us to be, and that's, He wants us to be that. He wants us to be that new creature in Him, to grow, to learn, to be a spiritual being for Him. So, if we want that for ourselves, then we have to do our part. Don't just sit here and say, do it, Lord. Most people want to sit on the bench and say, all right, let me have it. I'm a spiritual superman. No. Crack open that King James. Start praying. Ask the Lord to help. Let's do what we want. And when you mess up, don't throw it in the basket. Don't think that's it. Because we have that advocate, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. We confess our sins. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We don't have to dwell in our sins and beat ourselves up over them. We ask Him for forgiveness. We have that repentant heart. The song that Adam was talking about, we just turn from our ways and repent. The Lord is faithful and righteous, and He will. I'm going to read this last passage of Scripture from James 4 and 7. It says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Any time that you're struggling in this Christian walk, we all have our times. I've seen the strongest people that I thought was the strongest Christians struggle. And I've heard folks, in their last days before they left here, worried. Did they do the right thing? Did they do enough? Were they close enough? It happens to everybody. But we can turn to Scripture. We turn to what the Lord says. And we can know that everything's going to be okay. Submit ourselves to Him. Resist the devil. If he's bothering you, resist him. It doesn't say put up a fight and then fight back at him. He's resisting. We do need to mourn over our sins. The wages of sin is death. That's all the Lord's prayer and heart tonight to talk about. Preach from His Word, and I pray that it's helped somebody in some way. If I wasn't going to give an altar call tonight or anything, but, just pray that it's missing and find. Anybody got anything on their